So hello to everybody, and thank you very much to for the invitation. So I will try to share with you some experience I had on the last 20 years on working on interoperability, and I will make a particular focus on the ontology and what was done so far, what was the lessons learned, and maybe to give some perspective about the new needs that we have in terms of ontology, and in particular with reasoning, and what could be the things to develop, the scientific gaps to develop in order to make them a reality inside the industry. So the plan will be the following one. First, I will present you the industrial context where I've been working during these last years. I will talk about the non-interoperability issues. Then I will present how ontology were used and identified in the past as an interoperability enabler. And finally, the problem which are still to be solved in order to make them a reality in the today life to support digital continuity and continuous operational interoperability. So here it is a summary of the presentation sent before, but not the thing I will start with. I will start with a picture about the current situation inside the industry. So I've been working for Airbus for a long time. Airbus is delivering different complex products like commercial aircraft, satellites, launchers, defense systems. And what we can see as a current situation is that we have to deal with more and more complexity, complexity for the products we are developing that are more and more sophisticated and that integrates more and more technologies in terms of material, in terms of various disciplines, electronic, because the systems are disconnected, security, because we need to ensure that they will be safe on a very difficult situations, difficulties in terms of economic and regulation situation that we have to comply with. So these systems are the systems of interest for us that will become the product. And the current trend that is with a lot of acceleration is related to the systematic usage of information technologies. And today they are supporting all the processes that are computer aided. It is a case for the design, where we are using more and more modeling techniques, and the products are not anymore define and design on a paper basis, but they are taking advantage of digital technologies in order to model the product, but also to simulate its behavior and to validate it. And the mockups were replaced by digital mockups that allow really to validate the definition, to simulate, and to gain a lot of time and money in terms of testability of the product. And the definition are today available as catalogs that can be used by engineers in order to design faster their product and in order to solve and to validate that the solutions they provide are providing the best solution and in order to support them for verifying and validating that the solution comply with the client requirements, and also that they will really satisfy all the family of requirements, being functional or non-functional. So these systems are software systems that are by themselves quite complicated, and we have to deal with the fact that we need to deploy them properly inside the enterprise, and we also need to have the appropriate support. And if they are providing a solution for the efficiency of the engineers, they are also bringing their own kind of problems in terms of interoperability, because we have many products that are very heterogeneous, and the ability to make them communicate is quite difficult. And for this, it means that you don't need only to have capabilities and skills related to the kind of product you are developing, but also about digital practices. And you need to be sure that what you deploy will not lead to some silos between the different tools that you are using. So here it is, a supporting system for design, but we can have the same kind of things that occur in production with virtual manufacturing. You are more and more connected and intelligent robots in order to produce the product. And they are connected to the information system with virtual manufacturing. And more they are consuming models that are coming from the design in order to be able to, from the definition of the product, to have the good procedures and programs in order the robots to produce them. And the current trend is to rely on industrial Internet of Things, on different tools that can communicate with blockchain and smart standards, for example. And today there's a big effort on developing Industry 4.0. And even we are starting to think about Industry 5.0, where we will be able to have more intelligent production systems that are a second family of supporting systems for the system of interest. It means what we want to produce. And we have also to face some complexity in operation, because we are not only delivering the product, we are also supporting the people who operate and maintain the product. And we have to ensure to support the people delivering maintenance services or operating the system. And sometimes it is also part of the business that we are developing around the product we are selling. And for this, we also need to exchange a lot of information and to be aware about the precise configuration of each product instance that is in operation, and to have an history of all the maintenance and change operation that have been made on the product. And for this, once again, it is a complex situation, because we have to communicate with people that are not directly the people we are working on. They have their own information systems, they have their own processes, and we need to ensure some consistency between the information that we already have on these products and all the recommendations we may have concerning what is allowed to make with it or not. And here we have we may have a big problem in terms of responsibility if a problem occurs. And so we need to prove that what we developed and all the recommendations that we provided are not, in any case, the cause of any accidents. And for that, there's also a need for very complex applications that need to communicate with those of the various stakeholders we are working with, or those working on our products. So for all this context, that I think is not only the one of aeronautic, spatial, or defense industry, we are relying on various organizations. So it's not made by a single organization, but by several ones, all the partners, the equipment provider, the subcontractors of layer one or two, and all of them need, in order to work, to be able to exchange, to share, and to retain the models of the products and the associated processes all through the product life cycle. It means from the first line drawn about the definition of the product till the retirement of the last instance of the product. And between all the partners all along the time, with a very long life duration most of the time, a product may be in our domain living about 20 years. and even sometimes more. Sorry, I have to cut the call. So they may have to live a very, very long, and longer than the organization that are developing them or supporting them, longer than the application and processes that they are applying, longer than the solutions they are using, and longer than the information and communication technologies that we are using, that are very various, heterogeneous, incompatible, and it leads to have many information systems that are difficult to connect, and very often some silos between them. So if the product have a long duration of life, the technologies are moving and changing faster and faster with a growing pace of change. And it is an issue because it means that the tools that were initially used to produce the data will become obsolete, and we will have to change them. However, we need to retain the information and to be able to exploit them later on in the future. So we need to think about how to be able to archive the data, but not only archive, also to keep them alive and usable with the value system we will have to use all along the time. So it's something that is really critical. And if we don't do so, it means that we will not have the means to perform the appropriate support or to prove when we have to prove it in terms of regulations that we made the things the proper way and all these kind of things. So it's a very crucial and very important need for the industry in terms of interoperability.
Sorry, you are in slide four. You still in slide four? Or?
Yes.
Okay. Sorry.
No problem. So it's a slide with a lot of information, but after it will go faster.
We have
to deal with today a big challenge in industry is what we call the digital continuity for end-to-end process. So it means that we need the engineers to have something integrated with the models that can be used all along the life cycle with what we call a digital thread and digital twins. It means that the models are not only prescriptive and descriptive models, but they can also be reused to monitor and to collect information about the actual product in production or in operation, to have some loop in terms of feedback, and to be able to deliver other services in a close connection with the people from engineering. And it is a first one, but for that, it is possible only if we have a continuous operational interoperability of all the underlying system in terms of processes, business, in terms of practices, in terms of information system, and in terms of technologies. So here's the next slide. So we can see here another example for a product of what we are facing. We have a product, we have the integrator, that's it's the original equipment manufacturer, for example, Airbus. You have the clients, the aligned companies, as an example, KLM, and they will have to operate and to maintain the product with maybe some other partners. You have the researching partner with some equipment providers, and you can have also subcontractors or people saying just standard parts, and you have to face the fact that usually you have months of 50 first level subcontractors plus the subcontractors of level 2, 3, 4, and 5. So you have a big set of organizations that all are working on the products and have to exchange data, and they have internal processes that are private, and you have then the processes to collaborate with the other that can be, or you make the people applying your process, or you can have cross-organization processes that are about the collaboration between the different organizations. So when you are to deal with that, it can bring, here it's an example of a model with Archimedes about how the people are working together. You have the product on the top, the parts, which is the engine, and here you have one partner and the integrator, that is Airbus, and the other is Tecma. And for each function of the enterprise, design, production, and support, You will have different functions and departments, each having their own application, and all the applications being realized by the means of various software products that are deployed on an infrastructure composed of machines, networks that are all interconnected. And all this is most of the time very heterogeneous, and we may have some difficulties to have interoperability on three layers. The business one, so people have not the same processes and practices in terms of applications and in terms of underlying technology. So interoperability is to be made on the three layers. And if you don't have interoperability, it's a cause of interruption of operation, so non-efficiency and loss of money. The motivation is to prevent such a non-interoperability. And the goal is to prepare and build continuous operational interoperability of such a system. So in the past, in order to solve that, there were many initiatives where ontologies have been identified as an enabler for interoperability. So here, as an example, you have all what is was produced by the project called Interoperability Development for Enterprise Application and Software, a roadmap project. It was in 2002. And you can see here that they were identifying that semantic and ontology were an enabler in order to allow to have interchange between enterprise and their applications. It was not the only one. You had also to rely on model-driven approach in order to gain time and not make everything on paper-based. And you had also to consider the collaboration, the cross-organizational business processes, the application, and the information interoperability. So this was used also by all the further research activity in the interop network community that is still active today. You had the interop VLAB community that is still active today. So it means that it's a long story, and the ontology were really identified as an enabler. But one issue that I had to face is that they were not reusing the legacy open PLM standard, despite they were identified as key enablers. And it means that there were some needs to think about how to reuse the open standard as a source for ontology, and not to recreate from scratch each time an ontology by interviewing the people and redoing systematically the same work. In this research activities, I also saw that many people in standardization were also relying in ontology. So here is an example of the PLCS way of defining an ontology. That PLCS is about product lifecycle support, and it's an initiative that integrated in the way of doing the usage of ontology as reference data libraries. So it means a set of categorization of the product that can be reused and referenced when defining a product. And it was not coming from the PLCS community itself. They were relying on the experience of the community for the standard ISO 15926. That is about integration of lifecycle data for process plants, including oil and gas production facilities. And the part two of this standard is a data model that is in fact an upper four-dimension ontology that underlies all the production of the standard. And the standard was issued in 2003. So it means that it's about 20 years old. So here the message is, ontology as an interoperability enabler is not such a new thing, and it's something that the people have been working on for a long time. So 20 years after, what is the current situation? The current situation is that you have a new traction, and yesterday I was and the day before I was attending to OntoCommons. That is a new initiative at a European level that is about how to deal for Industry 5.0 with usage of common ontology that could address the new needs in terms of collaboration within Europe. And the idea was to say, how can we together produce an ontology-driven data documentation for the industrial people. So what can I say from what I heard? First, I can see that there's great ambitions and mobilization of the community. That is really a good thing, because the last years, I will say ontology as a technology for artificial intelligence was a little bit in the, I will say, forgotten due to the current success of technology for deep learning. And a lot of people are just forgetting that artificial intelligence is not limited to such technologies. And it seems that today, it shows that, in fact, you have the identification and some energy put around the fact that it can also bring value and help to solve some problems. You have also another initiative that is not so old, that is called the Internet Ontology Foundry, that is launched in the US with participation of contributors that are coming from the whole world, so from Asia or from Europe. And the idea is also to try to go from ontologies that are a little bit confidential and restricted to some area and maybe to research, to make it more industrial. And the idea of the Internet Ontology Foundry is to support the industry in order to create a family of interoperable ontologies coming with an architecture of reference that I am depicting it with several layers with different kind of ontology. So you have the foundation ontology that is underlying the things. You have the domain independent reference ontology. You have the domain specific reference ontologies. On top of it, you have subdomain ontology, and after you have the application ontologies. And the idea is to make them consistent and to produce them. Currently, the candidate as the foundation ontology is a BFO, so the basic foundation ontology that just became an ISO standard. I gave here the number, and all this should be, and there's a lot of work also inside the community for standardization, is also related to the effort to produce standards that are not anymore paper. And when I say paper, it means a PDF or Word document, so things that only dedicated to people, but to make them available and reusable by some automates. And so the idea is to make them readable, transferable, machine applicable. So the acronym is SMART, SMART standards. And it is something that is strongly related to the emerging need for industrial Internet of Things with smart contracts, with virtual manufacturing, and with model-based system engineering. And all this could, for example, support the digital threads for digital twins. So it means the ability to make the information about the product move from place to place in order to first start by the design model that will then be reused in order to capture information and to control, monitor what is occurring in production or what is occurring in operation. So it is a current landscape, but what I also heard yesterday is that some of the problems that we have been facing for ontology in the past are still here, and it means that even if the energy and the willingness to make the things progress are there, we have still fundamental problems that we have to solve in order to ensure interoperability. So the first family of problems is related to tooling. So for many people, they are discovering the domain and trying to identify what are the tools they can use. And very often, they are using something like Protégé with a reasoning engine that are open source one, like Pilot and some others. And what we can say about these tools is that even if they are really close to the state of the art in terms of research, they are maybe not often some tools that you can deploy in operation in order to exploit the ontologies that you have been producing for supporting the interoperability. So there's a lot of open questions from people. What can be used, what can we use in order to develop and use the ontology? Fortunately, I can say that today there's a trend with a lot of solution providers that today are supporting the ontology all, but maybe it's not so much known. And we have a lot of noise about all what is related to ontology, applied to knowledge base, applied to reasoning, applied to artificial intelligence. And sometimes the things are becoming a little bit fuzzy. And we can face, for example, a terminological issue when defining ontology. According to the kind of people and solution people are delivering, there's a lot of confusion. And we have various different definitions in order to define what an ontology is and what it is useful for. And so we are facing some fuzziness concerning also the fact that it is a part of artificial intelligence. So today, people having to find solutions that they will deploy in the information system and as I will say, solutions that are part of the information and communication technology are a little bit lost and they don't understand very well what they can use or not in order to deploy it inside the enterprise. What is also important is that even if it's something that can be used by researchers and by some individuals working standalone, in terms of strategy for deployment inside the information system, as I described you just before, we have to be sure that we are developing it properly, but also to be sure that we will have the required capabilities to develop, use and maintain and making evolving the ontologies. So skilled people, enterprise processes, shared practices, and so on. It is also something very important if we want the ontology and related services consuming services based on artificial intelligence. It is something that is absolutely mandatory in order to make ontology a solution for interoperability. And today, there's a big, I would say, heterogeneity and still a gap, an important effort to make some vulgarization about ontology and artificial intelligence, and also to make all the stakeholders understand clearly what it can bring, and also the people from ontology being a little bit more integrated with the others and being able to speak the language of people who are not ontologists, and also consider other issues they are not addressing at all. Most of the time, they are not the people who have the knowledge about the product or the processes, so they have to hear a lot. And also, ontology is something that is computer-aided, so reasoning require to have something computable, and we may also face some issue in terms of performance when we are using tools to produce and to consume ontologies. And most of the time, it's not in the area of skills of the ontologist to know and to develop tools that are performant and robust to be deployed inside the industry. So here it is the first family of issue we have. In terms of people, we have also to face the fact we have a lot of different ontology produced by many people at different places, and the ability to integrate them is sometimes difficult because they were not produced in the same principles, with the same upper ontology, with the same goal. We have also the difficulty to make the connection and to be clear about how it can be related to other communities for artificial intelligence, for big data, for data analytics, and for all what is data driven. So we have many kinds of experts that are very specialized, but their communication is sometimes a little bit difficult, and it's not so easy to see how to combine those different techniques as many different ways to solve problems using them together. We can also face some issue with what I will call the standard war So it means that when having to push something that will be a standard that will be used in the community. So for example, we may have the case for the upper ontologies of reference to be used. The question may arise, do we use a single one as a guarantee of interoperability, or is it something that maybe is not accurate and we may have to use several one according to the kind of problems and the paradigms we are based on in order to be really useful for the domain where it is applied. And may, oh, even the question of saying we need an upper ontology, or maybe we can use several of them, or to use upper ontology as something to define some patterns, but maybe not to tie very closely the upper ontology with the domain ontology, is also an open question, because upper ontology are most of the time a little bit complicated, and we can face some issue and constraints that it will bring with them that maybe could prevent the people to make the proper usage of what they are developing. So it's an open question, but a lot of, I will say, exchange I had shown that today we have several questions that are not definitively solved and that we need to address, because heterogeneity is here. And it's very difficult to impose a single viewpoint or a single way of thinking. So in addition to this kind of difficulties, we have also the difficulties from a scientific point of view. So in particular, the last years, I try more and more to assess what we can do with reasoning engine and rule engines. And I discover that in fact, according to the solution that you are using, you may have to face very various ways of defining the constraints or relying on descriptive logic. And then a reasoning engine that will rely on a subset of first order logic and that can solve some issues, some problems or provide services for all what is invariant over the time. And with some constraint to make some description of your solution, product, or data in a way that will avoid to have, I would say, class of classes. So you are really restricted to first order logic to be able to make reasoning and to have decidable ontology. And if you have to solve problems where you need to deal with a higher level ontology, it is a place where reasoning is not anymore applicable. And however, it is something that engineers with the complexities they have to deal with should need to be supported by ontology and maybe by artificial intelligence, maybe finding ways to deal with upper level of logic, more than the first one, and in order to face and to support them in solving problems that are not for which the first order logic is not usable. So it is an important issue, and probably it is a place where research and scientific gaps exist and that are still to be solved in order to provide and to support maybe some engineers and to make ontology more and artificial intelligence more appropriate for family of problems that today are unsolved. From a scientific point of view, another problem that I faced was about ontology that can be designed in order to be used with different kind of reasoning solution, and I will say different techniques in order to support this. So you have the example of all what is based on descriptive logic, and here it is one way to describe the things, but you have also all what is related to definition of rules that will lead you to have something that is not decidable, but will sometimes be more performance, for example, based on data log, So if we are considering the standards from the semantic web, we can think about all two with descriptive logic in one hand, and the SWRL that is about how to define rules that can be applied on top of all, but knowing that it's important to consider that some of the rules that we will produce with such a language may lead to have something that is not decidable. And it's a very complex topic, and how to drive these things and to avoid to have any fallacies or things that leads to something where we can't decide according to what was described and descriptive logic is a difficult topic. And it's also difficult due to maybe the fact that there's some scarcity in terms of tools, and as all are not, I would say, open, and it's sometimes difficult to compare the results of such or such following such or such rule. It's something that could be difficult to put in place in order to really have the good practices that we can define for the community in order to have a very industrial approach with a full confidence and trust. So it is definitively a domain where we should make some progress, and I think that where we need from the maybe to solve some gaps and also to support the industry with new solution to be provided for what is today not feasible in terms of state of the art. Another issue I identified was about the fact that when you have a lot of data and complex ontology, you have a problem of performance for the reasoning, because the combination of what is possible and all the links that can be verified with descriptive logic are sometimes too numerous, and it leads to some limitation in terms of scalability of the solution when you want to make a fast reasoning on a very huge amount of data. And today there are some techniques that are being developed, and some solution providers are proposing new ways of doing that are not necessarily based on all, but more on RDF with some way of expressing the rules. That may also deal with the fact that you can change these rules or the data, and that the recalculation of the inferred data will not be systematically recalculated for everything, but that you will track the things that have to be changed, and only change them when you are changing the content of your ontology or of your data. And it could be very interesting, in particular, if you want to embed such technologies in some tools where you need some performance, and where you need to have something that will not be too much bandwidth or calculation power resources. That will be very important. So but the problem is that you are not expressing the rules exactly the same way. And the idea is to say, how can you, in one hand, have something with rules for descriptive logic and descriptive logic-based reasoners, sometimes things that are relying on a rule-based reasoner, data logs, something like that. This is another way to create constraints and rules for ontologies, and in sometimes some specific tools that are very efficient, but maybe not based on open and standard way of doing. So it's something that brings some complexity. And if I have to conclude here, what I can see over the time is that, in fact, ontology domain is bringing its own complexity and heterogeneity to people who aim at solving digital end-to-end processes and continuous operational interoperability. So yes, ontology can support and be enablers to create interoperability, but they are by themselves, and also solution developers around them, are a source of complexity, heterogeneity, and sometimes of non-interoperability. So it's a little bit strange to see that something that aims at solving such problem are themselves part of the problem. And I think it's probably something that the community, the research community on ontology should consider and think about in order not to create some, I will say, the own family of problems that will be difficult to solve as the solutions they are developing are themselves part of the ecosystem they want to support. So some direction about what can be done. I will say that from a pragmatic way, the idea was to try in the past to find some short win and some use cases where you can help to solve actual problems about data interoperability relying on ontologies. And some directions that have been explored in the past across some research project and with some experimentation on the day-to-day work for operational programs, for standardization, and in order to try to really find new ways to deal with the problem. Have been developed over the times through a lot of articles and scientific publication, and some explore direction were the following ones. First thing is to say, okay, you can have many technology based on ontology, several formalisms, several languages, several paradigms. The idea is to say that you can't solve the problem of heterogeneity. It will always exist. It is a fact. And it's just to think that we can solve it by having a single way of doing, of thinking, or a single kind of approach is just not doable. And it will never happen. So stating that, in fact, you will have several representations of the things, of the product, using various languages and for different purposes, the idea is to say, okay, heterogeneity will be there, but can we make something in order all this representation to be consistent and with some preservation of semantic? If you don't preserve semantic and maybe all the data are not in all the representation, or to be aware about that and to trust it and to manage several representations of the same thing made for different purposes and aiming at being consumed by different kinds of users, but also different kinds of solutions and technologies that are not based on the same paradigms. And the concept is called a hyper model. So it's not something I invented and I extended it for from interoperability. And the idea is that such hyper model will be polyglot. So it's not about the natural languages that will be used, but it's about the different kind of technology that the industry is using. For example, for system engineering or software engineering, we are making usage of UML and of SysML. For the people, when we have to deal with ontology and reasoning or knowledge base, we may rely on all. And when you are working with enterprise architects, they will have their own language like Archimedes and some other open standards. And the idea is to say if all these representations are needed for different purposes, for different viewpoints for different disciplines, what about to consider the set of models and representations that you have to produce and to make them, I will say, consistent with what is an hypermodel, so a collection of various representations of the same thing for different purposes. So it is one of the directions that have been explored in the past. And I think that it can be also closely related to what is emerging for digital twins that will collect and aggregate the data coming from different places and for different purposes in order to establish a digital thread. The other idea is to say, okay, if you interview different people, experts at different places, you have very, very various way of thinking and doing, but we can also admit that all along the time, we had more and more open standards that have been developed, in particular for modeling language to support different disciplines, and that today they are open and they are also becoming de facto standards, so they are more and more used, and you have many solutions that are developing on this basis, being commercial or open source. And a lot of people in schools are teaching these languages. They are used in enterprise, and they are emerging as candidates, good candidates, so mature standards that could be considered as a good starting point for deriving ontologies, ontological representation of these languages, in order when you have model repository at different places, you can imagine that you will publish them as an ontology, and then you will be able to aggregate them in our relying on what ontology can bring, using or not using reasoning. So it's a direction that has also been explored. And in terms of solution, for example, there's a lot of experimentation of the Archimate language that for which some representation were produced first for all, so a derivation of an ontology from Archimate that can support reasoning, but also Archimate formalized on top of UML or SysML in order to be able, without changing Archimate, to have models that are modular and that can also support the production of models that are multi-scale models. Today, it's not possible with Archimate because it's based on a flat model, but there are some techniques, some approach that can allow to model over UML or SysML and to make the models really multi-scale with different granularities that are considered, but also modular, so it means being the, something that can be produced by several teams that will aggregate their model and to work together with a clear defined responsibility for managing the configuration management of the enterprise model that you will produce. There are also some experimentation to make the link between the BPMN language, no, the SysML language, sorry, and the IDEF0 language in step standards. You have application protocols with several models. One is called the activity model. It provides the big functions that you have to consider for the business and the flow of information between them. But IDEF0 is an old language, and you have a very few way of exchanging it between tools. And the idea was to say, if I have an application activity model defined in IDEF0, may I represent this model exactly the same one, but not using IDEF0, but using SysML. And this was an experimentation made in the frame of modernization of STEP, and it was demonstrated, and it's fully feasible to have to say you have exactly the same command artifact. So what is described is the same thing, but it is not formalized with the same language, or IDEF0 or SysML. And the idea is that to say it's really something that you can translate without losing any information. So it's another practical illustration of the principle that has been developed. And the idea is to say first, you can make it just as data that can be integrated as semantic graphs. But the idea is to say also, can we make it in a way that you will have some rules that will support reasoning? For example, to say that you will not to have explicitly to produce your models with all the links that you can deduce from logical rules. But if you are not computer aided, it will be a mess and a very difficult work for engineers not to forget to produce explicitly some part of the models. Here we can use artificial intelligence and reasoning engine in order to reify this kind of relationship. And we can also think about to combine and to aggregate these models having some equivalence between the language construct for each language you are considering, and in order to make, from a logical point of view, the hypermodel with several of these languages fully consistent, be computer-aided, relying on artificial intelligence and on descriptive logic rules. And the last point, last experimentation is about visualization. The representation can be a representation for computers. So it will be a code and it will be based on a language that are computable. But very often, most of the languages are today visual. And if you are using UML, Archimate, BPMN, you have diagrams, and you have some visual representation that should be also consistent with the other representation inside your application. It means the schema of the databases, the schema for data exchange. It means object models that you are using when designing your application. And in fact, there are multiple representations of the same thing. So what you see on the screen as a diagram should be consistent with the schemas, with the object model, and with all this representation of finally the same thing that is consumed and produced and used by several parts of your software solution in terms of software engineering. And due to this more and more important usage of visualization, the idea is to say, can we combine visualization techniques and technologies with ontologies and semantics, providing what is so called semantic cartography? And semantic cartography are representations that are fully explicit because you are relying on a language that is a visual one that is fully aligned with all the construct in terms of semantic of the language you are using. And so you have no any ambiguity when looking at the diagram because you have precise sign and way of drawing that are fully interpretable by the people reading the diagram. And most of the time, if you look at what is done day to day with PowerPoint and things like that, you have a lot of very nice boxes and arrows and things like that. And when you change from one slide to the other, you have exactly the same arrow and boxes, same names, but you are not representing the same thing. And it leads to a very difficult way of communicating between people. But let's imagine between solutions, it's even worse. So it's probably something to think about when dealing with artificial intelligence based on descriptive logic and all this area of artificial intelligence. How can we deal with that? And it could be something that can help to develop one thing that could be a direction in the future for information enterprise system. It's what I call enterprise navigation system based on advanced visualization techniques. It's a kind of, I will say, analogy with the GPS systems. Let's think about the past. People were traveling with paper maps, and it was a real nightmare in the past. And the idea here is to say it moves a lot. And today you have a GPS system in your car. The maps are interactive. You can see where you are because there's some contextualization and the system knows where you the car here and it can project here at the place where you are. And you can also interact with the system in order to respond to several kinds of questions. At the next road, should I turn left or right? Or what I discover that some traffic jam, may I change the travel plan in order to go faster? Or even if I want to prepare my travel in advance, I will say what is the most appropriate way to reach my destination? Do I use a car? Do I go by foot? Do I fly using an aircraft? It's the kind of things that can GPS and the tools like a Google Map can help to solve. And the idea is to say, oh, we can do this for traveling, but what about the enterprise? Can we imagine that the models and the representations that we are providing that would be visual and semantic would help you having some idea of the context of the user of the visualization service, having an idea about the context and how to respond appropriately to his response, knowing who he is, what is his role inside the whole organization. And it is the idea is what I name enterprise navigation system, and that could take advantage of ontology, artificial intelligence, and combine it with visualization techniques. I'm not so sure today if we look at ontology web language and the way that people are working about how to make visual representation. I think that there's still a ground for improvement and also some problems to solve. That are scientific gaps to address in order to implement such a vision. So if you are interested to know more, I put here some links on articles or publications related to these topics. It's kind of ideas, and I will say bottle launch for people who may have some interest to go further in this direction. And I think it's a conclusion of my presentation. So now we can go if you have some question, ideas, or things you are interested in. I'm at your disposal in order to respond.